Good morning and a very warm welcome to worship this morning from the Church of St Mary the Virgin here in Marden. Marden Church, as many of you know, was flooded four times over the winter season, and the flood recovery work was hampered by the current coronavirus pandemic. But we are hoping to resume services here during the month of August, as well as opening on a Wednesday for private prayer and for careful and supervised use of our library here. We hope to begin worship within the benefice here in the Mourned Churches next Sunday, and please do keep an eye out on the parish email and notice boards for further details. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. The glory of the Lord has risen upon us. Let us rejoice and sing God's praise forever. It's a great pleasure this morning to be able to welcome Janet and David, who will read for us this morning. Our gospel reading deals with the parable of the wheat and the weeds, and therefore there is somewhat of a harvest feel to our service this morning. And so we're going to begin with that great harvest hymn, Come Ye Thankful People Come.
Thankful people, come, raise the song of harvest home. All be safely gathered in, ere the winter storms begin. God our Maker doth provide for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come, raise the song of harvest home. All the world is God's own field, fruit unto his praise to yield. Wheat and tares together sown, unto joy or sorrow grown. First the blade and then the ear, then the full corn shall appear. Grant, O harvest, Lord, that we wholesome grain and pure may be. For the Lord our God shall come, and shall take his harvest home, and from field shall purge away all that doth offend that day. Give the angels charge at last in the fire that is to cast, but the fruitful is to store in his garner evermore. Then thou church triumphant come, raise the song of harvest home. All be safely gathered in, free from sorrow, free from sin. There forever purified, in God's garner to abide. Come, 10,000 angels, come, raise the glorious harvest home.
Our and an opening prayer. Tilt the scales, O God of the tiny seed, that the poor shall see justice. Share the feast, O God of Eden's abundant garden, that each crop may fetch a fair price. Upset the tables, O God of the upside-down kingdom, that the least can benefit from their trade. Open our eyes, O God of life in all its fullness, that we may learn to walk the way of your Son, tilting, sharing, upsetting this world, not satisfied until the gifts of the harvest give a better deal to all who hunger for one. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "Before you offer your gift, go and be reconciled." As sisters and brothers in God's family, we come together to ask our Father for forgiveness. Lord our God, in our sin we have avoided your call. Our love for you is like a morning cloud, like the dew that goes away early. Have mercy on us, deliver us from judgment, bind up our wounds and revive us. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. And so we have our psalm set for today.
Teach me thy way, O Lord, and I will walk in thy truth. Hold it my heart unto thee, that I may fear thy name. I will thank thee, O Lord, my God, with all my heart, and will praise thy name forevermore. For great is thy mercy toward me, and thou hast delivered my soul from the nethermost hell. O God, the proud are risen against me, and the congregations of naughty men have sought after my soul, and have not set thee before their eyes. But thou, O Lord God, art full of compassion and mercy, long-suffering, plenteous in goodness and truth. O turn thee again unto me, and have mercy upon me. Give thy strength unto thy servant, and help the son of thine handmaid. Show some token upon me for good, that they who hate me may see it and be ashamed, because thou, Lord, hast holpen me and comforted me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
For neither is there any God beside you whose care is for all people, to whom you should prove that you have not judged unjustly. For your strength is the source of righteousness, and your sovereignty over all causes you to spare all. For you show your strength when people doubt the completeness of your power, and you rebuke any insolence among those who know it. Although you are sovereign in strength, you judge with mildness, and with great forbearance you govern us, for you have power to act whenever you choose. Through such works you have taught your people that the righteous must be kind, and you have filled your children with good hope, because you give repentance for sins. This is the word of the Lord.
Bless the Lord, the God of Israel, who has come to set us free. He has raised for us a Saviour, sprung from royal David's tree. Through his prophets God had spoken of the hope the Christ would bring, of his faithfulness and mercy. Long ago God made a promise, He would set His people free, that in all our life and worship we might know truth. To be holy, to be righteous in His sight throughout our days. Now this child will be ways. Let all people know salvation through forgiveness of their sin. As our God in His compassion bids a shining dawn begin, so may all who dwell in darkness see the shadows disappear, while He guides our feet in pathways where His peace is ever near.
The second reading is taken from Matthew chapter 13. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, an enemy has done this. The slave said to him, then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, no, for in gathering the weeds you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest, and at the harvest time I will tell the reapers, collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, the one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so will it be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. This is the end of the second reading.
So this morning we hear a farming parable once more. Last Sunday the reading set was the sower casting seed in various places. Today we hear of the wheat and the weeds. While not many of you will be farmers, I'm sure that the problem of weeds in the garden is a problem familiar to many of us. We have firm ideas about what should be growing where, but someone else seems to have other ideas. During lockdown, I've had a little more time for gardening. We now have courgettes, beans, and tomatoes growing, and even some flowers. And yet the weeds are ever present. And in the case of the nettles in the vicarage garden, they've had the upper hand for quite some years. This picture must have been familiar to Jesus' first hearers too. Weeds growing among a valuable crop. Indeed, in the authorised version, instead of weeds, we hear the traditional used word tares. This word is thought to mean darnel, a rye grass which looks very much like wheat in its early stages of growth. Roman law prohibited the sowing of darnel among the wheat of an enemy, suggesting that the picture painted by Jesus of an enemy sowing weeds among the wheat is a realistic one. And this information helps us to dig a little deeper into this parable, I think. A weed that, in the early stages, looks the same as the wheat. By the time it has become evident that the plant is darnel and not wheat, it is too late. The root systems of the two are intertwined, and to pull up the one would pull up the other. The farmer must simply stand by and wait to sort the wheat from the weed at harvest time. Now, Jesus used this parable to teach us something about the kingdom of God. Parables are designed to be both memorable and thought-provoking because they contain familiar images, but often twisted in such a way as to contain an apparent paradox. I always think of the parable of the talents, feeling that the slave who buried the treasure was badly treated. Therefore, it sticks in the mind. Here, why should the kingdom of heaven contain enemies and weeds? Parables work at many levels. and prolonged reflecting upon their meaning can yield new insights as we are inspired by the Holy Spirit. Parables defy easy explanation. This is why I struggle with what follows next in our gospel reading. The parable is explained. It becomes an allegory, a story or picture that is interpreted to reveal a single hidden meaning. Some scholars believe that this passage, where the sower, the field, the good and the bad seed and all that are all carefully identified, is a creation of the gospel writer and not necessarily the words of our Lord. Time does not allow us to consider this argument in full. There is certainly not a consensus on the matter. However, if we set aside this explanation of the parable for a moment and concentrate on the parable itself, we are presented with a powerful image on which to ponder. A story about good and evil coexisting in the world, and a story about delayed judgment. When faced with daily tragedy, illness, cruelty, indifference, and conflict, it is easy to ask, why does God not act? Why does he not intervene to put an end to so much suffering in the world? And also, if God will not act, why should we not take matters into our own hands, exercising judgment upon those we consider to be doing evil things? This parable teaches us that good and evil do coexist, and for the sake of the good, the evil is not uprooted straight away. Tom Wright asked the question, would people really like it if God were to rule the world directly and immediately, so that our every thought and action were weighed and instantly judged, and if necessary, punished? If the price of God stepping in and stopping a campaign of genocide were that he would also have to rebuke and restrain every other evil impulse, including those we all still know and cherish within ourselves, would we be prepared to pay that price? For this leads to another facet of the parable that I think is overlooked by the following explanation. I don't believe that anyone is wholly wheat or wholly weed. No person is purely good or evil. We are a mixture of the two. We are human, after all. Like the intertwined root system of the wheat and the tare, the two cannot be disentangled in this life. Of course, it is beholden upon us as Christians to do all we can to feed and nourish the wheat, that good part of ourselves, and do all we can to diminish the weed. But we cannot, in our own strength, disentangle the two. I find this message of the parable gloriously reassuring. At the last, all those parts of us that separate us from the love of God will be cast out. This also means that for those who are so choked by the sin of others, God's love and mercy will prevail. We who live after Calvary and Easter know that God did indeed act suddenly and dramatically at that moment. When today we long for God to act, to put the world to rights, we must remind ourselves that he has already done so, and that we are waiting for the full outworking for those events. We wait with patience, not unlike people in a dark room wondering if anyone will ever come with a lighted candle, but like people in early morning who know that the sun has risen and are now waiting for the full brightness of midday. Amen. And so we come to declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed are the peacemakers. They shall be called children of God. From wherever we are, from wherever you are watching this at the moment, we meet spiritually in his name and we share his peace with one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So we take a moment to share the peace with one another if we are with somebody else, or to think and pray of those who we would like to share the peace with, and pray for God's blessing of peace upon them.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine! Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest, I in my Saviour am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with a goodness lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Saviour all the day long.
And so we come to our time of prayer together. In our prayers this morning, we use the response, I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. in our prayers this morning, we use the response, I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. Righteous Father, through your Son, we are adopted as heirs of your glory. Keep your church faithful to this hope. As churches across this land meet together once more to worship in our buildings, still the hearts of the anxious. Direct all we do to your glory. Open our hearts to be receptive to your awesome presence. I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. Righteous Father, give to governments due proportion in guarding and protecting their people from those of evil intent. We pray for our security services, our armed forces, and our emergency services. Turn all our hearts from ways of hatred to peace. I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. Righteous Father, your love shows compassion and restraint to children of your kingdom and to those who would disrupt it. Give us the same patience and grace to be agents of your transforming love. Fortify us in the struggle of your dawning kingdom. I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. Righteous Father, as we wait with longing for your glory, be with all who groan and endure hardship, those who suffer in body, mind or spirit, or who will be lonely this day. Bring your light to our darkness. I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. Righteous Father, gather to yourself all whose earthly days have come to an end. May they shine in the brightness of your eternal glory. I give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will glorify your name forever. And in a moment of quiet, we bring our own prayers before the heavenly throne of grace. Merciful God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as pass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love toward you that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And so we join these and all our prayers together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And so we sing our final hymn.
Hope of our calling, hope through courage won, by those who dared to share all Christ had done. Saints of today, Christ's banner now unfurled, will bring his gospel to a waiting world. Hope of our calling, hope with strength empowered, inspired by all that we have seen and heard. This call is ours, for we are chosen to live for God in all we say and do. Hope of our calling, hope with grace outpoured, from death's despair the gift of life restored. Up all to serve, to wash each other's feet, to bring Christ's healing touch to all we meet. Hope of our calling, hope by faith made bold, to sow God's righteousness throughout the world, bring peace from conflict, fruitfulness from weeds, the kingdom's harvest from the kingdom's seeds. Hope of our calling, Spirit-filled, unbound, all joys remembered and new purpose found, our core refreshed by sacrament and word, we go in peace to love and serve the
Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light upon our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all people in the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest upon you and all those that you love this day and always. Amen.